It's an honor to be here. Now, did everybody leave because I was about to speak? Or is there a class to come? Well, a lot of you are undergrads. If you need to go off and flee for a class, I totally understand how it is. I'm just happy to be back in sunny, warm Utah. I apologize for being late. I arrived here at about 2 minutes before 1 o'clock. I was trapped on I-15 with standing water. It wasn't what I was expecting for Utah. Sorry I missed the morning's session. And it's really, though, a pleasure to be here with such distinguished panel mates, and it's an honor to speak to all of you. Can I start first with a little commercial? I'm sorry, this is totally self-interested. I just published a book with my son, who's like 23 and just a recent college graduate. It's called, exciting title enough, The Constitution, An Introduction. There's a short story about it. I was at a conference much like this, and in the in the traditional academics dinner after the conference, around about the second bottle of wine, wait, can you do that in Utah? This argument breaks out between the law professors and the college professors as to when students develop these misshapen ideas about the Constitution. When did the students start to get everything wrong? And the law professors, like me and others, start blaming the college professors. What are you teaching these students? You know, you're messing them up. They get to law school, and then we have to correct all these bogus ideas. And they said, no. They come to us this way. It's out there in the culture. There are these pervasive myths about the Constitution. Not our fault. We do our best to teach them correct stuff. And I said, well, somebody really ought to write a book sort of aimed at real people and, you know, maybe students to try to, like, set some basic propositions straight. And my table mates challenged me to write it rather than write all these boring law review articles. And so I took the idea home. My son was in eighth grade at the time, and he had just had civics, and this is the hazard of being a law professor's son, okay? You know, he would read, Dad, look at this. The Supreme Court invented the doctrine of judicial review in 1803 in Marbury versus Madison, and we'd have a good belly laugh. Uber law nerds. They're probably worse forms of child abuse, but it's close. At any rate, we came up with the idea of writing a general readers, concise, nothing up your sleeve, description of the Constitution, its basic provisions, history of interpretation. We thought we'd do it in one summer. It took 9, because we were only doing it as a summer vacation part-time project. Finally got published this May. It's called The Constitution, An Introduction. And it really, this is all you need to read about the Constitution. Don't read anything else. Just get this. It's available on Amazon.com. Okay, that's enough of a commercial. As a professor, you know, you can't get along without a handout. Do you have the handouts? The blue handouts floating around, it's sort of the outline. You can tell if I'm staying on schedule. Okay. My title is The President and the Myth of Judicial Supremacy. And I'm going to emphasize the myth of judicial supremacy. In some ways, this will build on what Lewis Fisher has said. My thesis is that the president has a fully co-equal power of constitutional interpretation. The myth of judicial supremacy is probably what you were all taught in junior high school civics class, that the Supreme Court gets to decide the meaning of the Constitution. My thesis is that the power of constitutional interpretation is not a power exclusively assigned to the Supreme Court. There is no textual power of judicial review, let alone judicial supremacy, that makes the Supreme Court the uber boss over everybody. It just isn't in there. Rather, the power of constitutional interpretation is a power that each branch has, incidental to its core functions. The reason the judiciary can interpret the Constitution is because they have to decide cases, and the Constitution is supreme law. But by the same token, Congress interprets the Constitution every time that it first decides whether it has power to enact a law. And the president has a co-equal power of constitutional interpretation incident to every one of his constitutional functions. Execution of laws involves interpretation of the Constitution as supreme law. interpretation of many of his other powers, the decisions to pardon people, the power to issue vetoes. Each presidential action can involve a circumstance of constitutional interpretation. And under our Constitution's scheme of separation of powers that Jonathan Turley was emphasizing, the Madisonian vision is that no branch would be supreme over any of the others. In fact, in Federalist 49, you can pretty much quote it by heart, it's one of my favorite Madison quotations, Madison says, wait, I can't do it by heart, I think I have to find it. The several departments being perfectly coordinate by the terms of their common commission, neither of them, it is evident, can pretend to an exclusive or superior right of settling the boundaries between their respective powers. No branch, in short, is the boss over any of the others. The power of constitutional interpretation is an incidental power that each branch possesses, and each branch may press its positions with all the constitutional powers at its disposal, and that the process of constitutional interpretation is one of mutual branches checking and balancing each other, fighting with their competing interpretations. Now that's a nice arid statement of the thesis. Let me make it concrete. You know, you're taught to do that when you're teaching students. I have a hypothetical. Now, I don't know how Utah Valley University classes are. Do you sit in lectures and take notes passively? Law classes, it's this wonderful and terrifying teaching method where the professor begins, it's called the Socratic method, and they ask questions. And the students are supposed to come prepared and answer the questions, and you are cold called on. The professor, you know, meets your eyes and says, Ms. such and such, will you state the facts of such and such a case? And then you're off to the races. Okay, here's my hypothetical. I won't call any. I won't cold call any. Congress passes the Alien and Sedition Acts of 2017. Okay. The Sedition Act of 2017 makes it a crime, a capital crime, to criticize the government of the United States. In fact, if you publish or write or speak anything against the government of the United States, you are hereby deemed guilty of treason and shall be executed the next Friday afternoon. Okay. And you are hereby deprived of all of your constitutional rights of trial. There shall be no judicial review. And the president shall carry out the order immediately. And your execution will work a corruption of blood and forfeiture of assets for the next four direct generations of lineal descendants. You with me on the hypothetical? Can we pretty much agree that the Sedition Act of 2017 is unconstitutional? Not, I won't call on you if you're nodding. Yeah, is it an violates the First Amendment, violates the definition of treason, violates due process of law, even violates the corruption of blood and forfeiture of assets provisions of the Constitution. As unconstitutional as it can possibly make it, okay? Here's my question to you. There has been no judicial decision in the case. Is the president bound to execute, literally, is he bound to execute the Sedition Act of 2017? Can I call on people? Can I take a volunteer? No. I'm going to assume that you would say, no, the statute is unconstitutional. Are you with me? Okay. The statute is unconstitutional. Could the president veto the bill on the ground that it's unconstitutional? Yes, of course, he should. Okay, what if it's passed over his veto? Does he have to enforce it? So, well, isn't it still unconstitutional? Yes, isn't it? Then I continue with the hypothetical. Suppose the Supreme Court goes absolutely bonkers, as it's been known to do a time or two, or three. And the Supreme Court in a test case, let's call it, can I call it Fisher versus United States? Professor Fisher challenges this, files a lawsuit, and goes up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, 9-0, upholds the constitutionality of the Sedition Act of 2017. What? The Supreme Court got it wrong. You're the President of the United States. do you execute Professor Fisher? Now, it's interesting, I get law students because they're often thinking, what is it I'm supposed to say? What is it that the professor is thinking? And they'll say, yes, I'll execute him because that's what the Supreme Court said. They said it was constitutional. I said, well, wait a minute, a second ago, you said that the Sedition Act of 2017 was flagrantly, horribly unconstitutional. You say, yes. Does the Supreme Court saying the wrong thing make what was flagrantly unconstitutional suddenly constitutional? I go, no. I say, I put it to you again, Mr. Smith. Does the president have to execute, plainly contrary to the Constitution, Professor Fisher, just because the Supreme Court said so? And this puzzles them because we are all deep-seated consumers of the eighth grade civics class myth of judicial supremacy. Okay. The right answer is that each branch can fully check the others within the sphere of its powers. Let me just briefly run my outline and sort of sketch the core points of this. My first bullet point is what I call the irrepressible myth of judicial supremacy. Nearly all of constitutional law today rests on the myth that the Supreme Court created the doctrine of judicial review in Marbury versus Madison, and that that power of judicial review gives them the exclusive and final power to dictate to the other branches. Nothing in the argument for judicial review in Marbury versus Madison remotely supports that proposition. Instead, it's become the civics class myth. John Marshall's argument for judicial review is actually a very straightforward textual, structural, logical argument. It has the intuitive appeal of a geometry proof. Sorry, I didn't mean to create any bad images. Premise one, the Constitution is supreme law. Premise two, anything that is contrary to the supreme law is unconstitutional. An act of Congress that is contrary to the supreme law, to the Constitution, is therefore unconstitutional. Perfect, simple, straightforward, Euclidean geometric proof. The next step in the argument is the branches are co-equal and coordinate. Congress saying that the law is constitutional and passing it doesn't control us in the exercise of our independent responsibility. Therefore, we may say that the law is unconstitutional, even though Congress has said it is constitutional. It is unconstitutional, and therefore, in the exercise of our judicial power, we refuse to carry it out. John Marshall then adds a further argument that we all swear an oath to uphold the Constitution, and it would be criminal, make a mockery of the oath, if you were to interpret the Constitution but have to defer to what another branch said where you're fully persuaded that what they said is wrong. Okay. Said that would be an absurdity too gross to be insisted upon. I love this archaic language. Okay. Now, the short point I want to make is by that exact same reasoning, there's a parallel power of presidential constitutional review. Think about the premises again. The Constitution says one thing, an act of Congress or an act of the judiciary says something else. The Constitution trumps the unlawful act by the departing from subordinate authority. Constitution trumps the faithless act of a faithless agent misinterpreting the Constitution. And the president, likewise, is independent of the other branches and swears an oath to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution in the course of performing his duties. It follows, as night the day, that the president has a parallel, co-equal power of constitutional interpretation. The argument is exactly the same. And historically, this has been exercised by many presidents in many different forms. Okay? Vetoes. Presidents veto laws on constitutional grounds. Professor Fisher highlighted President Jackson's veto of the rechartering of the Bank of the United States on constitutional grounds that had been rejected by the Supreme Court. President Jackson's argument is, they don't control for me. I swear an oath to uphold the Constitution, and that means I interpret the Constitution as I faithfully understand it, not as somebody else understands it for me. Okay? Pardons. There was an original Sedition Act of 1798 making it a crime to criticize the government. Jefferson is elected president in 1800, and he immediately pardons people who had been convicted under it. Now, the interesting thing is the judiciary had upheld the convictions under the Sedition Act of 1798. They had upheld the act against constitutional challenges. Jefferson's view, they have a right to speak for themselves, but they do not have the power to control my independent actions as President of the United States. I hereby pardon them on constitutional grounds rejected by the court. Okay? Similarly, I hereby decree an end to all prosecutions under what I conclude to be an unconstitutional statute. And that's my second illustration, presidential power to refuse to execute a statute on constitutional grounds. Where the president concludes a statute is unconstitutional, he should refuse to enforce it, the same as the judiciary should refuse to enforce a statute the judiciary concludes is unconstitutional. Many, many presidents have done this. Jefferson, Reagan, Bush, Clinton, Bush, Obama, presidents do this all the time. Signing statements. Presidents often will sign a bill with reservations saying, I sign this bill into law, but I have constitutional objections to certain provisions of it. I cannot be bound to enforce those aspects of a law that are unconstitutional. I will therefore interpret the statute as not commanding me to do anything unconstitutional. Many presidents have done it. Another area of independent presidential interpretation. Another famous example is sometimes presidents will refuse to defend the constitutionality in court of laws they think are unconstitutional. You might think of it as rolling over and playing dead, right? We are sued on the ground that the statute is unconstitutional. The proper action, if a president concludes that a statute is unconstitutional, is not to defend its constitutionality. President Obama tried to have his cake and eat it too. With the Defense of Marriage Act, the federal ban on same-sex marriages, he said, I think this act is unconstitutional, therefore I will not defend it in court, but I will enforce it so as to create a judicial challenge. Okay? It's like, wait a minute. If the reason you will not defend it is because you think this is an unconstitutional statute, what on earth are you doing deliberately enforcing within the powers at your disposal a known unconstitutional statute? Now, you can disagree with Obama on the merits of whether it's constitutional or not, but under whatever view you have, the president must be consistent. It makes no sense to refuse to defend a statute, but nonetheless to enforce it. One last example, then I'll quit and we can finally go to questions and answers with when this really livens up. Okay. The most extreme instance of co-equal, parallel presidential power of interpretation is what I've referred to in the past as the Merriman power. And it comes from a case arising at the outset of the Civil War. Okay. Capital is surrounded. Maryland is a hotbed of secessionist sympathy. Virginia has seceded, and there's problem getting the troops from Massachusetts and New York and Rhode Island into Washington, D.C. to defend the Capitol. Lincoln authorizes a suspension of the writ of habeas corpus. He tells the commanding general, if you need to just arrest people and hold them under military authority in order to get the troops through, you can do that. One of the persons arrested somehow gets access to a lawyer and files a petition for a writ of habeas corpus and asks the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court to issue a writ of habeas corpus. He does so and directs the general at Fort McHenry to bring the prisoner for adjudication of his status. The general sends a lucky subordinate to say, President Lincoln has suspended the writ of habeas corpus, and Chief Justice Taney says, you can't do that, he can't do that. And he invalidates Lincoln's suspension of the writ of habeas corpus. Lincoln's response, quietly, was to defy the writ of habeas corpus and to defend the correctness of his position on the merits. Okay? Lincoln was like the first true practitioner of parallel constitutional review of the lawfulness and correctness of even a judicial decree. Now that becomes kind of heresy if you're really steeped in the myth of judicial supremacy. But go back to my hypothetical where the courts have upheld something on constitutional grounds and the court's decision is clearly wrong. You are President of the United States. The Supreme Court has upheld the Sedition Act of 2017 and ordered the execution tomorrow afternoon of Professor Louis Fisher. Do you pull the trigger?